phải trang do you see my screen?
No, there should be an icon.
I clicked on sharing the screen.
Okay, now it comes.
Okay, thank you very, much.
Okay, yes.
Well, this talk really, first of all, is shared the presentation by me, but it is shared with Dr. Daniel Seed, a colleague from the Catholic University, Pontifical Catholic University in Santo Domingo. An outline of what I'm going to say is I'll talk first of all about the development goals and then about synchrotrons and the specific method of this top of this workshop, and then what is our proposal of a new synchrotron. Well, the climate, agriculture, and food, first of all, are three arguments which are interrelated between them, with each other. I don't have reason to give details about that. I would just mention that if one looks at the sustainable development goals, many of them have to do with climate, agriculture, and food. Here, I list the seven, which are clearly related, but perhaps one could also find others. A colleague of us in Australia, Vito Del Rio, considers that 13 of the 17 goals could actually be related to these topics. What is a synchrotron? Well, a synchrotron is something which is obtained as a consequence of electromagnetic law. If one has electric charges which are accelerated, they emit radiation in a direction which is perpendicular to the acceleration. And this can be made, for example, in big tubes, which are circular tools, in which, in order to make the electrons circulate along the circumference, one must have an acceleration directed toward the center. And this has two important consequences. The first one is that the electrons lose energy. And since they lose energy, if we want that they don't spiralize and remain going along the same circumference, one must give back the lost energy. But this is a technical issue which can be solved with electric field and so, but I'm not going to discuss this point. But the main point which is relevant for us is that because of this acceleration toward the center of the circumference, radiation is emitted perpendicularly to that and therefore tangentially to the path. This is the synchrotron light. But the synchrotron light has another characteristics. It depends, this characteristic depends very much on the velocity of the electron within the ring. When this velocity approaches the light velocity, then the synchrotron light is a beam of photons which is increasingly collimated. What are the main features of the synchrotron light? Well, they're basically four main features. The brilliance, which essentially means the number of emitted photons, and is related to the size of the area from which the light is emitted, and as a characteristic of a very small divergence around the beam. Then it is highly collimated. One can tune very much its wavelength, which means that one can study different wavelengths. In practice, this means for example, in the area which is of interest for us, the Twantenev X-rays, which have a very specific wavelength, and also it comes by pulses, and it has a very short pulse duration. The very short pulse duration, which may be in the order of nanoseconds, means that one can, in practice, can take picture of a molecule or a protein or so with interval of time of the order of nanosecond, and therefore one can study the evolution of it with this type of times. Of course, these features have been reached through a certain process, technical progress, and this corresponds to the different generation of synchrotrons. Currently, we are in the fourth generation, and the fourth generation started a few years ago, and currently there are only three synchrotrons in the world which are fourth generation synchrotrons. One is in Brazil, one is in France, but it is a European collaboration, and one is in Sweden. Nevertheless, this is the current trend in synchrotrons, and therefore many others have been upgraded, like, for example, the Berkeley of Stanford synchrotrons in the US. The interest of synchrotrons comes for their applications, comes from the fact that their applications have a very big amount of versatility. You see here a list of them. They cover hard science, teaching, industrial development, medical imaging, governance, but I put in blue, and also soft science. We see here anthropology. Well, in fact, with synchrotrons, one can study the teeth of Neanderthal men, our ancestor, the Neanderthal. And but I put in blue those which are of more interest for the purpose of what I'm going to talk about. They have important applications in biology, in geophysics, in the study of water, in the study of environment, and about climate. So going specifically to the three topics I want to go to discuss, namely climate, agriculture, and food, let's start by climate. In climate, there is a panel, which is the IPCC, which has three main working groups. And these correspond to the three main subjects of climate: basic sciences, and adaptation and mitigation. The adaptation means how one can perform actions which can reduce the problems which come out from the climate, which are produced by climatic change. Mitigation is a way of trying to reduce the impact of the climate change. And this basically, for example, the main way, line of interest is to reduce the concentration of greenhouse gases. And synchrotrons with climate have many applications. I here give just some example of applications of use of synchrotrons which have to do with climate. One can study the impact of moisture and microbes on soil carbon, and this is relevant for the reduction of greenhouse gases. One can study new materials at the level at nano level. And this also has implication for chemical studies, for example, referring to paleoclimatic periods. One can work for energy production in order to make energy less dependent on fossil fuels, and this as a consequence, again, in an improvement of climatic situation. But going to agriculture, I would say X-ray, which are the main, the aspect of synchrotrons on which I put attention, were already used in agriculture before. It was since about 100 years ago. They were used basically for the quality of the products, to produce biological change in the products, and the main difference with the new the opportunities provided by the synchrotrons is that since they are a bright source of monochromatic S-ray, one can make use of them to make a non-destructive analysis of agricultural products, but not only of agricultural products, also of the soil structure and of water characteristics. And for example, one must say that what I just mentioned, soils and water, is not only interesting in agriculture, but for example, it's very important for fisheries when one studies, for example, deep water behaviors. What is the advantage of these things? An advantage I would like to underscore is that one can have a very good image contrast. This is interesting not only for food and agriculture, also in medicine, clearly. And this makes possible to overcome the problem which comes when one wants to study some problem, something, and what we want to study is very similar to the background of the image. So the big contrast makes possible to spot what really one looks at, distinguishing from the background. Most of my comments will be about food. About food, the applications of synchrotrons are really many applications. Here, for example, one can use them to optimize the nutritional value of the food. How? Just looking, for example, how the certain nutrients go in certain specific vegetable space species, like cereal grains. And this makes possible to make a selection of among different grains which are similar, of those which are better to retain the nutrients we want them to retain. There is a recent review I quoted here, which is made by a group of the Canadian light source. In this talk, I will refer to many examples taken by some source specifically, the Canadian, the Australian, the one in Spain, Alba, and the one in Barcelona, which is in Barcelona, that of Grenoble, because they are specialized in this type of problem. And another possibility is that one can use X-ray techniques to enhance the understanding of structure of the foods, in order to increase food safety and security. Here, I can give you four or five examples which of uses of synchrotron for food. For example, chocolate is produced in six different polymorph crystallizations. They have very different characteristics for what concerns their taste. And using synchrotron, one can, as it has been possible, to lower the temperature at which one produces the best form. And to lower the temperature is not just a curiosity, it's something which implies a tremendous saving of money, because it means that one uses much less energy. But I'm in Spain, I can tell you, in Spain, the ham is very famous, and there are very different qualities, and their difference depends to the alimentation given to pigs. Now, in order to avoid that one sells as the good, as expensive ham, ham produced by pig, from pigs which are fed through a low quality alimentation, one can again use the synchrotron, which would reveal which kind of alimentation was used for those pigs. Another possibility is the preparation of a coffee ready to drink, which can last for several months without losing its quality. One can enrich in iron the rice, but In the case of red wines, one can study the presence of tannins in red wine, which in fact red wine, for red wines, the presence of tannins makes a lot of difference in their taste. But very interesting applications concerns packaging. For packaging, it is possible, basically what one usually often does is to study the materials of the packaging, and this is the object of understanding the interaction between food and package, the way in which the persistence of the food in the package may degrade the material. And also a very recent, a few days ago, the study of the fiber nanostructure in materials of packaging. This was relative to the to certain aspect of the packaging, and has been object of a big project between Tetra Pak, the Swedish company, which was one of the first. It was the first in packaging, and Max4, which is the synchrotron in Sweden, in Lund, I was mentioning before. But then again, about remaining about food, an interesting aspect that concerns the GMO. On GMO, we listened already to talks which gave much importance to GMO. And the GMO, really, in many countries, is mainly a political problem. In Italy, we just heard there are groups which are against GMO for philosophical reasons. But for example, in Mexico, and this is relevant for the agreement Mexico has NAFTA with Canada and the United States, 1 week ago, the government decided to veto the use of transgenic mice for human consumption. So this also presents the interest, for example, of selecting through synchrotrons particular species of some material or some good, which have the advantages which would be given by the GMO. For example, in the case of maize, one of the problems is the resistance to climate change. And maize has 1,300 species or 1,600 1,300 species in Mexico. So one can study which ones are more resistant to toughy climate change, to climate change. The same could happen also for coffee. The importance of the, when in Brazil, there is a freezing is tremendous. But for toffee, one can also try to identify species which are toffee resistant. And this is very important in the economic context of Latin America, because in Latin America, basically, the exploitation of natural resources and agriculture.
Sorry, Professor Violini, we have maximum 5 or more minutes to come to the end of the presentation.
In fact, this is now what I'm going to say, to conclude in 5 minutes. In agriculture and the natural resources are very important, and this makes important, for example, the development of precision agriculture. However, if one looks at the synchrotrons in the world, one finds that only one synchrotron exists in Latin America and no synchrotron in Africa. Nevertheless, in Latin America, there is some important big infrastructure, but it is mainly in astronomy and in astrophysics. Instead, for concerned synchrotron, the one I was mentioning is the one of Campinas, and little success has been obtained by certain proposals which have been discussed in Colombia, in Mexico, in Cuba, and Puerto Rico. So perhaps this was due to the fact that they are national programs. And in fact, our proposal is different from the previous ones in Latin America because it is a regional proposal. Here is the reference to it. What is the cost of a synchrotron of the sort we have in mind? It's between $300 and $500 million. Its operation is about $30 million. First of all, I want to say estimate of the return of this investment can give up to 300% of the investment. But apart from this, it is compatible with the economic capacity of the region and possible sites where it might be, could be in several countries, certainly Mexico, Colombia have the scientific capacity of having a synchrotron. Additionally, there could be the possibility of a linkage with an analogous project, which since 7 years, is discussed in Africa. Why is it? This can be done in different ways. Can be done, this linkage may come from the for the training, from the linkage with international organization, for the role of support from advanced countries. And to conclude, what we have done until now. Well, we have a working group working on that since about 1.5 years, where we have made several presentations of the project, both in seminars or talks like this, or in workshops, symposium, conference, and we have a strong connection with other synchrotrons around the world. But for the future, what we have in mind is, first of all, to promote a foundation or association to create it in order to promote the project. We are going to organize a multi-venue symposium in June between 5 countries potentially interested to the project. We have to do to perform a technical detailed articles, diffuse the project, and make the training for people to use it. This is important because often synchrotrons are considered just a physics tool. Actually, they are based on physics, but their main applications are in biology, are in agriculture, and in many other things which have nothing to do with physics. We already gave a name to our project. We call it L'Amistad. L'Amistad in Spanish means friendship. And the reason is that we truly looked for a word of Spanish interpretation, but with a meaning in English. And I would like to thank a number, first of all, the colleagues of our group, L'Amistad, among whom, to whom belongs also Daniel Seed, who is actually watching this, assisting to this talk. And she's linked to us since several hours. And a number of colleagues who have been discussing with us the project and also commenting specifically this presentation. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, Professor Violini, for your very interesting presentation. I think we don't have time for questions because we are really short on time for lunch. So thanks a lot again. We'll have time for more questions in the afternoon though. So for those who have questions left from the morning talks, stay online and we'll get back to those in the afternoon. So now we go for lunch and I kindly ask you to be quick on lunch because we need to be here at 2:00.